is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
I'd like to mention this again for those that missed it earlier on. We do have an update in regards to our voting information in respect to voter registration and validation exercise. Look out for gazetted polling stations for general elections 2020-2021 in the new vision and Bukeda TV on. That is tomorrow, Tuesday, 17th Dec 2019. For those of you who respect and value your vote, endeavor to have this done, especially tomorrow, as we of course try to wrap up this communication coming through from the Electoral Commission, that is of course just across the road. Away from that, let's talk about what happened in the SACAFA Senior Challenge Cup, where the Uganda Cranes of Jonathan McKinstry finished their group stage campaign and beaten with a 4-1 victory against Djibouti. Now the focus is on the semi-finals. A enjoyable done there, must say, it was the obvious that the Uganda Cranes had to get all 3 points all through. But again, for me, the question will be, will McKinstry join the likes of Mitchell, the likes of
Bobby Williamson
in regards to winning the SACAFA? Because this for me is one you probably might say Merry Christmas to me, having taken on the job as a Uganda Cranes head coach.
If you're McKinstry, like, and you've ever coached in Africa, Uganda Cranes is not your first team that you're coaching in Africa, and you cannot win a SACAFA Senior Challenge Cup at home soil, then like that alone may be
questions why you're in the job.
Exactly. So for me, and when you look at actually our group, I didn't expect actually Uganda Cranes like to lose a single point. Mm-hmm. And for me, I wasn't actually surprised, like finishing the group with 100% record, and I expect them actually to beat Tanzania in the semifinals and they go on and lift the trophy, because we are the hosts. Mm-hmm. And like, we have a good record when it comes to SACAFA Senior Challenge Cup, and we have the quality. We have the quality compared to other teams. So there is no shortcut. McKinstry has to deliver the trophy.
Down in Jinja, Brian, Ayub Khalifa and company got the job done on Friday. I think Friday, beating up on Djibouti, Eritrea. He led 10 goals to nil yesterday over the weekend, I think I'm not mistaken. Drawing with Tanzania. Tomorrow is finale day. A draw or a win will have them lift and add on what they already have in terms of success.
Yeah, it's a round robin format, which means that they get to play against each of the opponents just a single time. And when it's all said and done, the team that finishes with the highest tally of points will be crowned the champions. And if you look at the standing so far, for the girls, it's still a 100% record. I think the only team that comes, it's pretty much what they're still unbeaten, but they had that draw against Tanzania. Mm-hmm. And 3 wins and a draw, that means that they are on 10 points. The team that is closest to them is Tanzania. They are on 8 points. And then you've got Kenya on 7 points. So it looks like these three are the teams that are in the running for the title, because below them, you've got Eritrea, you've got Somalia, and you've got Djibouti, who are bottom. And again, for Ayub Khalifa, I think for me, he's been riding off the momentum coming through from the fans who have had a free interest into the games. Mm-hmm. Key players like Fauziana Jemba has been scoring in pretty much every single game. The goals from Juliet Nalukeng have been as important as they come. At the beginning of the show, mm-hmm. I mentioned her being one of the front runners for the player of the tournament. And I think for me, the top scorer, and rightly so. You could speak of players like, Mahimuna, who has put in quite the shift. So you can look at this team and you're feeling like they've got a big career ahead of them. They've got a lot of games coming through as well. And I think for me, altogether, 2019 has been exceptional for women's football. And you can clearly see where it's heading in the years to come.
Well, in Rwanda, we do have the BAL qualifiers. That's the Basketball Africa League qualifiers set to unfold. Our very own City Oilers, who successfully convinced FUBA to have the playoffs postponed after they came out displaying concerns of fatigue. But that being said, they will be down in Kigali. They are down in Kigali for the BAL qualifiers. Can they qualify? Can they actually stand out? I want to believe they will come out strong, just like they've done all the recent years, the Zone 5s. And that for me is a huge, huge, huge one for Jordan and his boys, because you want to think, having turned out quite as favorites in the Zone 5s, where they came out on top 2017 or 2016, this one here might be another for them in regards to adding on their success. But that being said, qualifiers coming through in the BAL Africa League, what can we expect from this very good Oilers side?
First of all, there's two pools. There's only six places for teams to join the ready qualified. What they did is that FIBA, which is the international body for basketball, has partnered with the NBA, and they've come up with the Africa League. But to get there, you need to play through the qualifiers. And there's six teams that have actually been given automatic qualification. I could speak of Angola, there's Egypt in there, there's Nigeria, there's Senegal, there's Morocco in there, there's Tunisia. So all the other nations have to go through qualifiers. And the City Oilers are in Pool B. Their campaign starts tomorrow. They'll be playing against KPA from Kenya, who for me are the strongest team in their group. They've got to play against Maputo from Mozambique, and then they've also got to play against the sports club from Sudan as well. So you're thinking if they can pick up a decent performance, then they'll be qualifying as one of the six teams to join the already qualified six. And the downside has been that they've had some key players that are going to miss out. I could speak of Stephen Omoni, who is going to be undergoing surgery early next year in January. I could speak of players like Francis Azoliba, the Nigerian import that they've got in the team as well. So the key players will be guys like Ben Komaket. You could speak of players like Ivan Muhwezi in the team, Josh Johnson as well. And for all Ugandans, we shall be rooting for them. And them going down to Kigali, Rwanda, is such a big opportunity for them to continue to get better and expose themselves. Recently, they won the first qualifiers that happened in Tanzania. That was in the FIBA qualifiers. So for me, City Oilers look like a team that is well prepared, and we expect nothing short of qualifying for the big continental tournament.
Well, there are live draws for the UEFA Champions League and for the UEFA Europa League after the Champions League draws have been done. And it's only one thing. We have the four English club sides already in the knockout stage. Chelsea, Tottenham, along with Man City and Liverpool, the cup holders. Who will they be facing? That is something we shall be getting into a little later from Lauren, who will be giving us an update. And for us, as far as Arsenal are concerned, well, tell you what, they might be dropping themselves a big bite, because then there might not even be Europa League football for them if they continue the way they're continuing in the EPL. Any updates, Lauren, from the Champions League?
Yeah, of course, the draws are done for the UEFA Champions League. Yeah, Dortmund will be up against Paris Saint-Germain. But of course, a big game will be Real Madrid up against Manchester City.
That's interesting.
Zinedine Zidane up against Pep Guardiola. Sorry. Atalanta up against Valencia. Atletico Madrid will play Liverpool. Then Chelsea, Bayern Munich, Lyon will be up against Juventus, Tottenham Hotspur up against Leipzig, and Napoli up against Barcelona. First legs will be played on the 18th and 19th, then 25th and 26th, then return legs at 10th, 11th, then 17th and 18th of March to see which team progresses to their quarterfinals.
Soft spot for Jose Mourinho, Red Bull Leipzig. Yes, we saw what they did in their cup run, but you like to think that Chelsea, no chance. Man City, I don't want to
Chelsea up against Bayern Munich.
That's a replay of the 2013 final. Quite an interesting one there, I think. For Pep Guardiola, the hope will be that he can get the best out of his team against a Spanish side that probably he knows a thing or two about, having had a stint with Barcelona. I think for me, the other interesting one has got to be Atletico Liverpool. That's a good game for the fans.
Liverpool, yeah.
Well, we shall get into that, of course, tomorrow in regards to the UEFA Europa League, getting our opinions, and you can have yours as well on our Facebook page and our Twitter page, that is at abantv.uj. Away from that, let's now get back to the local stories, because then Hiddens came out to baptize Impis with a defeat. As for Warriors and Rhinos, which was the biggest fixture of them all, Rhinos having the final say, maximum points secured in the bag. Rhinos, of course, you hosted them on Friday, both from Warriors and Rhinos, and clearly both sides were prepared for themselves against each other. But that being said, Rhinos for me looking like a whole different side from two seasons back.
For the Warriors, actually, it's now 3 wins out of 3. They had that quite closely contested game, but they went on to win 10-8. Interestingly, you could speak of the big win for the Heathens against the Impis. They put 59 points past the Impis team, which also meant that they went home with a bonus point. They had nine tries on the day. Arthur Mukama being the outstanding player for the Heathens, picking up a hat-trick of tries. Aaron Ofoirof, as always, he didn't disappoint with his kicking because he converted 7 of the 9 tries. So, for me, I think the Heathens are now in cruise control. They are the reigning champions, though there was wins for the Pirates and for the Cubs as well. So, it's still early days. This is only 3 weeks of rugby action that we've seen so far. But I think for the fans, they've got such an interesting campaign ahead of them. But it looks like the league is now starting to pick up, and the fans should be looking out for something exciting.
Let's look elsewhere on how results came through from all over the grounds. Match day 3 in the rugby, a Premier League wins for Heathens on the day. As far as their title defense gets to go, remember they came out on top against the Cobs. They did come out on top still against the side in Impis of the weekend. And that being said, Those are not the results in the Rugby Premier League, but of course we do apologize for that. Quickly away from that, let's quickly dive into EPL Match Day 17. A very sad outing from the Arsenal of Freddie Ljungberg, the interim head coach at Arsenal, who came out three goals in the first stanza of that game, doing collateral damage on the horse in Arsenal. And I must say, for me, this kind of takes you back to Arsenal looking much worse than they were under Unai Emery. It's getting worse by the day. And there might be a question coming through that, will they even qualify for Europa League?
Yeah, it's going to be very difficult for them unless they react very quickly. Like the Arsenal board, they need to react, the directors of the club, because right now, actually, Fred Ljungberg, they thought that maybe Fred Ljungberg will be the kind of person who will try as much as possible, like, to narrow the gap, the gap that actually had winded between the technical team and between the players and the technical team when Unai Emery was still in charge. But actually, he has failed to deal with it. And, like, it's just getting worse and worse. And for me, like, they need to react as early as possible. They need to get a coach. And I'm not surprised to see, like, today, actually, I think a few hours back, Dembele was right here, had a story that Arsenal directors actually held a meeting with Mikel Arteta, though I still don't think that maybe Mikel Arteta is the right man, actually, to take Arsenal where they want to be. I do still think they need a coach like Carlo Ancelotti, because this is the kind of coach actually who has actually handled so many big clubs. He has the experience, he has that winning mentality, he has the character, he has everything. But when you look at Fred Ljungberg, like, at one stage I saw him like just seated when Arsenal is struggling,
accepting defeat.
Exactly, accepting defeat. And actually, before the Arsenal game, I had watched Man United drawing 1-1 with Everton, and the way Duncan Ferguson actually was doing it on the touchline, and you're like, what's Ljungberg doing? So for me, I really think they need to react as early as possible. They need to get a coach who's going to take Arsenal where they want to be.
Three moments for me, Brian. One was the defensive errors that we've seen over the last 2 or 3 years or so. Three big moments right there where you had Raheem Sterling and Kevin De Bruyne having bags of space. Three red shirts attacking one player, leaving Raheem Sterling bags of space before he put the ball into the back of the net. The other was Mesut Ozil kicking his gloves after being taken off on 59 minutes. And then the final one was the injury blow to Kolasinac. You want to think Arsenal right now are very vulnerable. But even then, while we talk about or discuss how they need to get the rightful man for the job to replace the interim coach in Ljungberg, you've got to worry for them, because in there is a few things. No desire, no hunger, no leadership. That being said, where do they head from here as they face Everton coming up?
I think, for me, truth be told, Arsenal look like a team that is lacking a sense of direction. First of all, for most of the players, they are not sure what is going to happen in terms of the coaching. So that leaves a bit of uncertainty. Mm-hmm. And then on the day, you could clearly see that for Manchester City, the strategy was let's come out of the blocks, the better team. And when Arsenal pushed quite forward in the early exchanges, all they did was to catch them on the counter. And quite the masterclass from Kevin De Bruyne. For me, he was absolutely outstanding. Mm-hmm. Arguably, his best game this particular season for Manchester City. Scored two goals, had an assist for Raheem Sterling. As soon as Arsenal went behind in the opening 2 minutes, you could clearly see that they didn't have a comeback, they didn't have a response in them. Mm-hmm. And certainly for Manchester, they continuously kept catching them on the break. And again, like you mentioned, the back line, without players like Tierney who are out injured, and without players like, that is Hector Bellerin, there is a lot of spaces down the flanks. Mm-hmm. And that is what Man City kept exploiting. And again, when Arsenal were two goals down, what I was looking out for was a response. I wanted to see the players put in a shift and look to get back. That didn't happen on the day. So clearly for Freddie Ljungberg, it looks like he's not the man for the job. Mm-hmm. Just like Lauren mentioned here, there's been reports going around that Mikel Arteta is now the front runner. Mm-hmm. It looks like the board probably will be considering him. But for me, ultimately, there was no Lacazette on the day. He was left to warm the bench for the better part of the game. Bukayo Saka came on. He was quite ineffective. Aubameyang was quite isolated up front. For Mesut Ozil, he had come out before the game and attacked one of the Chinese people, and they chose not to broadcast the game on the state channel. So for me, Arsenal looked like a team that need a lot of work to do. But for Man City, it was very important that they went away with all the 3 points, because we all know, had they failed to do that, then they would have fallen for 17 points behind Liverpool, and you don't want that to be happening right now.
Well, the Arsenal remain in ninth place, their fifth defeat of the season and their sixth in a row against Man City, who got back to winning ways. They're back in business, though 14 points adrift of Merseysiders. Liverpool are down in Qatar for the FIFA Club World Cup. And I tell you what, for Arsenal, it could get worse if they do lose against Duncan Ferguson's Everton side this very weekend. Still conversing about the EPL with Liverpool, of course, 2-0 winners over Watford. And I tell you what, it gets even better because Everton almost beat United.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game on is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Ekitongole kikola ku byokulonda mu ggwanga ekyeyerekeddwa.